Hello and welcome to Steins Gate 0. I am Trunks1A2 and we will start the story. The hatch opened. Bright light flooded my eyes. Where was I? My eyes narrowed. I could barely make it out the summer's twilight sky. I didn't want to leave. I just wanted to disappear. But someone grabbed my arm and dragged me out. I didn't have the energy to respond to my own nickname. I fell to the ground and wrapped my arms around myself. Mayuri ran to me and looked down, her face worried. But her kindness felt like nothing but annoyance. Don't talk to me. Just leave me alone.
Okarin, Chimamire-chan, doushitan?
Dou-san, towel to mizu, ato fuku mo, imasugu te ni irete kite.
Dou iu koto ka, setsume please.
Ii kara hayaku.
Daryl ran to the door that led back inside the building. Stop it. Just get away from me. Leave me alone. I couldn't serve her. In fact, I killed her myself. Right there. Right here, 3 weeks ago. I killed her. I'm a murderer.
Muda datta nda. Nani o yattemo. Muda da. Zenbu. Kimatte shimatte iru koto nan da yo.
No matter how many times I try, it will all converge back to the same result. The process doesn't matter. Whether you time travel or time lapse, you can't go back and change the results of the past. Thought I understood the cruel truth. But now I was forced to realize it again, and in the worst possible way.
こうなるって予想してたんだ。もう疲れた。ずっと休んでないんだ。だからもういいよ。
一体何が。
俺が殺してしまった。バカみたいだ。全部俺のせいだ。
マキセ・クリソーさん、刺し殺しちゃったんだ。殺した？嘘、そんな。でも安心して、まだもう一回分タイムトラベルはできる。
ほっといてくれ。俺のことなんか何度やったって結果は同じだ。
何言ってんの？諦めるつもり？オカリンおじさんの肩には何十億っていう人の命がかかってるんだよ。たった一回の失敗が何だって言うんだ。
クリスはどうやったって助けられない。世界線の収束には逆らえない。
That's the reality of this world. I learned that a long time ago.
こうなったら、ビンタしてでも気合い入れ直して。ダメだよ。マレジンするのは良くないよ。こんなボロボロになってるオカリン、見てられないもん。でもさ、このままじゃ未来を変えられない。どうして未来のことをオカリン一人に押し付けるの？そんなの重すぎるよ。オカリンおじさんには世界の観測者としての能力があるからだよ。オカリンが望んだわけじゃないのに。それにもう一度やったってまたオカリンが傷つくだけだって思うな。未来のことを人一人で変えようなんてきっと無理なんだよ。だからそのためのシュタインズゲートで、気持ちはわかるよ。でもさ、私も未来をかけてここまで来てるんだよね。どっちにしろ2036年には戻れないんだ。そう簡単に諦めるつもりはないから。オカリンおじさん、一つだけ忠告しとく。このタイムマシンに残されてる燃料は有限なの。さっきは往復2回分しか残ってないって言ったけど、実はまだそれなりに余裕はある。それでも移動できる時間はおよそ344日分。片道のタイムトラベルだとしても、今から1年と経たないうちに7月28日には届かなくなる。覚えといて。その日になったらさ、私はたとえ一人でも飛ぶよ。
Someone was saying something to me, but I couldn't understand the words. I didn't want to listen to anything. I just wanted to sleep. Just let this all end. Just let me go.
Okari? Okari? Ne? Okari? Mo? Gambaranakutemo ii kara ne? Naitemo ii in da yo? Okari?マユシーはそばにいるからね、オカリン。
I don't know if Mario's words were the reason why, but the tears started to flow. I decided to forget everything. Ever since that day, I stopped going to the future gadget lab. OPX, the new symbol of Akihabara, was located right in front of the station. In the hall on the fourth floor, preparations had been going on all morning for the ATF Akihabara Techno Forum Convention. Universities and labs from both inside and outside the country would work together to put on special seminars and symposiums at irregular intervals. My school, Tokyo Denki University, was participating as part of its industry collaboration effort. Students were required to attend these seminars and submit reports to the instructors. Otherwise, they wouldn't get credit for the related classes. In addition, I was supposed to help one of the lecturers, Associate Professor Izaki. I had just gotten a list from the reception desk at the shared lobby. I was waiting to check off the names of students who were coming to the lectures. There was still some time before the seminar started, so the lobby was mostly empty. None of the students on the list were here yet. I was bored, but I couldn't do anything but wait. The old me never could have imagined how anything like this, but the impression Izaki was part of my new golden life. Victor Kondaira University. Yes, that was my new goal. Izaki did a lot of joint research projects with them and knew a lot of people there. The best first step to getting there my brain could come up with was being his assistant. Also, this convention was holding another seminar by Victor Kondaira University after the one held this summer. Of course, that interests me too. Summer. An image of her as she was flashed through my mind. I was trying to get to Victor Kondaira so that I could learn about the work that Kurisu Marquis has been doing. I wanted to try to do it myself. Of course, I wasn't a genius like Kurisu. I knew there was no way I'd ever be able to do exactly what she did. But if I could even do even 10% of it. Honestly, I'm amazed that I've recovered so well. I thought that to myself and chuckled, just as a voice called to me across the lobby. I looked up and saw a young girl approaching from me from the elevator hall. She was short and petite. Everything about her was small. I could kind of make out a few of the curves that don't appear until after puberty. So at least she wasn't in elementary school, but maybe middle school? For someone with such a cute face, she clearly didn't care about her appearance. Her hair wasn't styled and it poured down her back. Even I could tell her clothes weren't very fashionable. Clearly not a place where a middle school girl belonged. She'd probably just come to the wrong place. Irritated, she pulled a card off her jacket. It was one of the IDs given out to invited guests. Her name and the name of her workplace were written on the front. What? Victor Kondaira University, USA, Brain Science Institute. I looked at the card and then at her, then back at the card, and then I looked at her again. I finally realized. She signed and showed me another card. This one was a photo ID from Victor Kondaira University. It was the same ID I seen Kurisu holding before on another word line. The photo on the card Yeah, that was definitely her. Unlike in Japan, it wasn't uncommon for Americans to skip grades. Furiso had made it to university at age 17. But still, a girl this young working in a university lab. She got me. The girl, Maho Hiyao, pointed to part of the ID with her slender fingers. She was born in 1989 and it was 2710, so... Then she puffed out her chest. There wasn't much to see, but I could imagine her saying, "They look bigger when I'm not wearing clothes. They're huge." I couldn't believe it. She was older than me. If Daryl was here, he'd be dancing out screaming, "Leech the lolly for the win." No. Still, the Brain Science Institute. That's where Kurisu works. Which means the kid, no, this person, might know a lot about Kurisu. I held back the impulse to start badgering her with questions. I looked at the pamphlet with the seminar schedules. Victor Condria's lecture was the last one for the day, and was clearly intended to be the biggest. Was this Mao Hiyao girl going to give a lecture? Just like Kurisu had done at the summer convention. No wait, that's wrong. That never happened. Kurisu Makise never gave any lecture over the summer. That happened in the Alpha World Line. In the World Line I inhabited now, before the summer convention, she'd already. I looked in the pamphlet again and saw that the lecturer was a name named Alexis Leskinen. Alexis Leskinen. A professor at Victor Conrad University and the chief researcher of the Brain Science Institute. I led Maho over to the elevator hall and showed her where the staff room is. I had no reason to hang around her any further. I said goodbye and was just about to turn around. Just then, the elevator opened, a woman emerged. The instant I saw her face, every hair on my body stood on end. Mueka Kiryu. It was all I could to do, keep myself from screaming. Calm down. This is a bitter word line. Mayuri is alive. Wacker's not going to kill her. Our eyes met. The eyes on the other side of her glasses were as dead as ever. It was impossible to tell what she was thinking. I frantically averted my gaze before she realized something was wrong. She titled her head for a second, but quickly lost interest in me and turned away her mouth. Even this word line, Weka still only spoke in faint whispers.
Leskinen 教授はまだなんです。少しお待たせしてしまいますけど。はい。それまで私でよければシステムの概要でもお願いします。
The two of them disappeared into the staff room. As I watched them leave, I took a deep breath. I tried to calm down, but it wasn't working.
Kiryu Moeka. Moshikashite. Mata. Omae naro ka?
It was a terrible feeling, like a cold finger tracing the wounds in my heart. That night, when the terrorist threat shut down all the trains in Akihabara. That awful night when I just knew something was going to happen.
ここでもまた。お前が。
Or was it just imagining things? She was just a magazine reporter now instead of a CERN rounder. No, even if Moeka was a rounder, we had nothing to do with CERN anymore. CERN wouldn't be watching us. I took another deep breath, grabbed some of the energy mats in my pocket and swallowed them down with some mineral water I bought ahead of time. It would take 15 minutes for them to kick in. Those 15 minutes were always pretty rough. I laughed at myself a little and sat down on one of the reception desk chairs. The table was filled with leaflets, pamphlets, and other things for the attendees. My eyes wandered to one of the pamphlets. Nakahabachi theory and the genealogy of pseudoscience. This pamphlet was for Professor Zaki's seminar. Nakahabachi theory. The paper he announced in Russian. That paper has the key to creating a real time machine. On that day, July 28, Nakabachi had stolen the paper from Kurisu, his own daughter, and left with it. I knew that. Only Nakabachi and I knew that. I flipped through the pamphlet. It was a brief introduction to the many forms of pseudoscience and fake scientific discoveries that had emerged since the start of the 20th century. On its own, it did make for interesting reading. And at the end of the pamphlet, Nakabachi's theory was introduced as nothing more than another entry in that long list of fakes. So Dr. Nakabachi's time machine theory had been completely ignored by the academic world. All the glory, fame, and power he wanted so badly that he was willing to get rid of his own daughter. He didn't get any of it. And I heard rumors that after the announcement, he'd been imprisoned in the Russian lab. To make it even funnier, he thought he was getting VIP treatment. For a short time, there were essays and interviews in bogus academic journals. Even there, it was obvious it had all gone to his head. The ironic thing was that Nakabachi's theory was completely correct and completely revolutionary. The Russian government was worried about it leaking, and the SVR was doing everything it could to keep it under wraps. But under the surface, there was a full-scale information war, beginning over the paper. The time traveler from 2838, John Tittle, had told me so, which meant it had to be true. Was World War III really going to happen? There was no point in thinking about it. Just a little more before the drugs kicked in. I closed my eyes. Several hours later, the convention was going well. After Prosecco Izaki's seminar, most of the students come from my own university went home, but I killed some time and came back. I wanted to hear the Victor Condrea lecture. I headed to the hall with plenty of time to spare and saw Mao Hiayu coming from the staff room. She was with a very tall fauna. Was that Alexis Leskinen? It didn't seem like an American name, but maybe it was an immigrant like Corizo, or at least descendant from one. I didn't mean to eavesdrop, but the looks on their face were so serious that I couldn't help but listen. Since we were both speaking English, I could barely make out any of it, but I could tell from their voices that it wasn't a pleasant chat. Wait, did I just hear the word Marquis? I hated the fact that I couldn't speak English. If I had known this was going to happen, I would have gone to an English school. The two of them walked into a waiting room to lecturers. It was located right next to the UPX theater. I put together a few fragments I was able to understand. A fire at Corizo's house. Mrs. Marquis is alright. Robbery. The police called off the investigation. Why was the FBI there? Didn't make sense. I think that's what they were saying. Corizo's house? Do they mean where she lived in America? Her mother should still live in America. Is that where the fire was? And then words like robbery, and then the investigation was called off. I really wanted to know more. Stood there and worried until it was too late, until it was time for the lecture to begin. With nothing else to do, I went inside the theater. I could tell earlier by looking at the size of the crowds going inside, but it was a very high energy crowd. The atmosphere was clearly different than in Izaki's seminar, which was mostly students there for credit. The place was nearly full with a crowd of scientists and people who wanted to learn about cutting edge technology. Victor Condrea's researchers had published a slate of papers on science recently, and had gotten a lot of media attention. Maybe that was why. Were there any open seats? Found a single open seat at the edge. But when I looked at who was sitting next to me, I moaned. You again? Moyaka Kiryu was there. She was speaking to no one, just typing endlessly into her phone. I once named her Shining Finger because of her incredible typing speed. She was fast. She was as fast as ever. Who was she talking to? I didn't even want to imagine. I quickly turned away and looked for another seat. Dr. Leskinen reached the podium almost the exact instant I sat down. There was a huge wave of applause. But when they saw the tiny little girl come up next to him, the applause faded into confused murmurs. Mao must have expected this. Her expression didn't change in the slightest as she stood next to the professor. In fact, when she took the microphone from the professor and looked around the theater, she looked like she belonged there. Ladies and gentlemen. First, Dr. Leskinen began to speak in English. When he made eye contact with Mao, she began to interpret.
Thank you for ビクトル・コンドリア大学脳科学研究所のアレクシス・レスキネンです。専門は脳信号処理システムおよび人工知能理論になります。そして私は助手のヒアジョー・マホです。同じく脳科学研究所で教授の指導に沿って研究をしています。よろしく。
The audience started murmuring againIt was the same way I responded when I met her. Well, that will happen,
yeah. Then, I will introduce our テーマは人工知能革命としましたが、これからデモンストレーションするシステムはおそらく皆さんの想像を超えたものではないかと思っています。
Nuclear skin started in front of the laptop that had been placed on the podium and started to type.
このパソコンですが、研究所のスーパーコンピューターの一つと接続されています。ああ、まだプロジェクターには映さないで。
One of the staffers was about to display the laptop screen on the front projector. Some kind of important programmers have been booting up because Mao Hiayo stopped them.
すみません、まだ開発途中なんです。非常に美的センスのないプログラムが画面いっぱいにあふれかえっています。こんなチープなプログラムを見られるのは恥ずかしい。裸を見られるよりもね。この中にエンジニアの方がいるなら理解していただけますよね。
Some of the audience got the professor choke and laughed.
起動するまでの間、このシステム全体の概略を説明しましょう。
There was another projector in the center of the stage. A diagram appeared on the screen. And at the top of the diagram was a Japanese translation for the general audience. An analysis of neural pulse signals relating to memory stored in the temporal lobe.And knew the title well. In fact, I was sure I was, could never forget it. It was the title of an essay written by a 70-year-old genius published in Science. She had completely analyzed the nerve impulse patterns that govern human memory and used that to digitize the memories themselves into data. And she had used that to invent the time loop machine right in front of my eyes. So, none of that had actually happened anymore.
サイエンス誌に掲載されたのでご存知の方もいるでしょう。これは私たちのチームにいた天才的な日本人研究者によって提唱され完成されたものです。人間の記憶は大脳皮質、とりわけ側頭葉に記録されます。いわゆるフラッシュメモリみたいなもの。そのメモリに記憶を書き込んだり読み出したりするのが側頭葉にある海馬傍回という部位になります。
Dr. Luskin pointed to the diagrams of the brains in the hippocampus on the screen.
脳はニューロンと呼ばれる細胞の間を電気信号が伝わっていくことで働いています。記憶というのも実はこういった電気信号の伝わりの一つなのです。その働きを制御しているのが海馬傍回と言ってもいいでしょう。つまり電気信号が海馬傍回を出入りすることで記憶は作られていくんですね。そこでマキセ・クリスはこの論文を書いた日本人研究者です。マキセ研究員は考えました。海馬傍回を通る電気信号が電気信号のパターンと大脳皮質の
Mao started to have troubles with interpreting. She was getting confused.No matter how good you were with languages, interpreting for a long period of time had to be difficult. I once read an article on the internet that said even a professional can do it more than 20 minutes. International conferences and live broadcasts from overseas were actually handled by a team of people switching off. Or maybe, was she having trouble because Chris's name came up? Dr. Luskin saw she was having trouble and cut himself off.
マキセ研究員は海馬傍回を出入りする電気信号のパターンに着目しました。そのパターンが 大脳皮質のどの記憶と対応しているのか解析を行って完全なデータを得たのです。これによって記憶という曖昧でアナログなものを電気信号のパターンの組み合わせというデジタルのものに変換する基礎理論が確立されたのです。これがサイエンス誌に掲載された彼女の論文です。そして現在私たちのチームはその理論をもとに人間の記憶をデジタルデータとして取得するシステムを開発しています。
Wave of whisper swept across the theater.
それはすなわち人間の記憶をコンピューターに保存しそれを活用するシステムということになります。
The whispers turned to a low roar. I see.So even after her death, Carissa's research was being carried on. Of course, maybe it was natural that it would be. It was a basic theory of time for time leaping, which I had proved myself, even if I could never prove it to anyone else in the Alpha World line. My memories had been turned into data and stored on a computer. There was no doubt about it. And what Dr. Laskinen was talking about right now was the basic technology required for that process.
現在、私たちが行っているプロジェクトは主に2つです。1つは医療分野への応用です。
The slide on the projector changed.
こちらは精神生理学研究所と共同で行っているプロジェクトです。コンピューターに保存した記憶データを海馬傍回を通して再び元の脳に書き戻すというもので、
Someone who looked like a grad student in the front row shouted. Dr. Laskin didn't seem particularly put off by the interruption, more continued to interpretation.
信じがたいですか？その気持ちは理解できます。私も皆さんの立場であればそう言ったでしょう。しかしこの研究に私たちは手応えを感じています。これが実用化できればどんなに素晴らしいことでしょう。例えば老化による記憶障害、あとはアルツハイマーなど、そうしたものへの対処療法が期待できます。患者の記憶をデータとして自動的にバックアップしていくのです。記憶が失われたとしてもその都度 PC にアクセスし脳内にデータを再インストールすることが可能です。それによって忘却の進行を食い止められるのではないか、私たちはそう考えています。
Well, butWhat if when they forgot how to get it from the computer or that's stored on the computer? Yeah? Sorry.
最終的には海馬傍回から PC 内の記憶データに常時アクセスできるようになるでしょう。そうすれば脳機能が失われた状態、例えば脳が激しく損傷したり萎縮してしまった場合などですが、そのような状態でも変わらず脳機能を維持できます。あたかも外部ストレージと同じように。
A strange feeling gripped the hall. Part of it was shock and the feeling that we witnessed the announcement of an incredible technologyPart of it was skepticism that a system like this could ever actually work. Part of it was revulsion at the idea of playing around with a human brain like that. An excitement born of all these things passed from one member to the crowd to another. Dr. Laskin raised his hand to encourage questioners.
どうやら2つ目のプロジェクトをお話しする前に質問を受け付けないといけないようですね。 できる範囲でお答えします。どうぞ。
Many hands were raised. I could tell that there was a wide age of range of people interested. Both young and old were raising their hands. Dr. Laskinen pointed to the questioner. This was the first question. Sampling would be required when digitizing analog memories. Does it mean any information would be lost? The professor nodded as he listened to the question in Japanese and began to respond in English when the speaker finished. Maybe was able to understand Japanese, if not speak it.
その質問を言い換えると、オーケストラの生演奏をWAVのデータに保存する際、生演奏のすべてを完璧に記録することはできないと。確かにその懸念はあります。現在の研究で最も困難な問題の一つです。脳内のネットワークが神経伝達物質のオンオフだけで、つまり二進数的にデータのやり取りをしているのであれば簡単な問題でした。それはデジタルデータと同じことだからです。しかし実際には伝達物質や電気信号は脳内でアナログ的に変化することが分かっています。この問題に関しては今のところより高いサンプリングレートでデータをサンプルする方法しか手段を持っていません。音楽の話で言えば 44.1kHz よりも 48kHz、 48kHz よりも 96kHz でサンプリングするといった具合です。それによってデジタルでありながらアナログデータに近い情報を得ようとしています。
Little by little, the mood in the room was turning to disappointment. People were beginning to wonder if this was just a pretty theory that wouldn't work in reality. More questions came. All of the questioners were skeptical of the professor's theory, and many of them seemed to be outright challenging him. I started to get upset. This was Dr. Laskinen's research, but it was also Kurioso's. He knew better than anyone that it worked, and the sight of so many people refusing to give it a chance infuriated me. Were these people really scientists? I tried to keep myself under control and looked back towards the podium. Was she mad? She certainly looked disappointed. Dr. Laskinen was very polite with the rude questioners, acknowledging the problems with the theory. She was very different. Her anger was starting to seep into her interpreting too. I felt a kind of kinship with her. The question and answer session continued.
そもそも、これは医学的に無謀でしょう。デジタルデータを脳に書き戻すなんて、絶対に不可能だ。正気の沙汰ではない。サイエンス誌に掲載されたあの論文も読みましたが、にわかには信じられない。ましてや、筆頭著者が若干17歳の女性だったとあっては。
That was a thing I couldn't ignore.
あなたね。
異議あり。
Objection!Amy Gate, it's Ace Attorney time. The two people on the stage and the entire audience all turned toward me at once.
やってみもしないで、何がわかるって言うんだ。最初は無理だと思われてた技術なんて、この世にいくらでもあるじゃないか。でも、それを克服した研究者がいたからこそ、今があるんだろう。ただ批判するだけじゃ、何も生まれない。
The whole of the other went silent. But I didn't regret standing up.
あなた。
On the stage, Mao Hiayu was staring at me in shock. And as for Dr. Laskinen, I saw a flash of white teeth as our eyes met. He started to applaud. Why was he applauding? That just makes things embarrassing.
素晴らしい。彼はなかなか大したやつだ。ですって。
Miles translated the professor's words for me to hear.
ただし、科学者たるもの常に冷静でなければいけない。大声で怒鳴っていいのは、実験が成功した時の。We did it!それだけで十分だそうですよ。
すみません。
I lowered my head and sat down. I thought I was calm, but I guess I let my emotions get away from me. I hadn't grown up at all in the past 6 months. If Kurezu was here, she'd make fun of me again. I could feel the rest of the audience staring at me coldly. It hurt.If I could have left, I would have wanted to, but I was too interested in hearing the rest of Dr. Laskin's talk to move.
それでは皆さん、そろそろ次に。でも、その前に勇敢な彼に拍手をお願いします。
Oh no, please no.
彼のような挑戦者こそが科学を進歩させ、あっと驚くような理論を作り上げるのです。彼ならきっと第三のアインシュタインになれるかもしれませんね。ちなみに第二のアインシュタインはここにいるちょっと小うるさい私の助手。変なこと言うのはやめてください、教授。
The audience chuckled. Sheesh.
さて、ここで私はしばらく通訳をお休みさせていただきます。これから私よりも優秀な通訳が登場します。これが私たちのチームが今最も力を入れている二つ目のプロジェクト。アマデウスシステムです。
When she finished speaking, Mao walked to the back of the stage. At Dr. Laskin's signal, the PC screen was displayed on the projector, and then I heard her voice. The murmuring got louder than before, but it felt more uncertain than surprised. On the screen, I could see a detailed 3D model of Maho, the girl who just interpreted.
映画などで有名なドリンクワークススタジオに作成してもらったモデルです。
Mao Hiayo chimed in from the back of the stage.
声については、私のボイスサンプルをデータベースにして、日本の山名が作ってくれました。
This was CG. It sure looked real to me. The professor said something into the laptop's microphone.And then the 3D model of Mao Hiayo on the screen opened its mouth. If you listen carefully, you might be able to hear something slightly off. But it sounds far more human than any of the artificial voice I ever hear.
しないのかと、とてももどかしく思っていましたよ。以前から感じていましたが、どうも教授は人が悪いようですね。まったくだわ。
The Maui Ayo on the screen spoke with a slightly irritated expression, and the Maui Ayo by the wall nodded in agreement. Dr. Laskin simply smiled. What was going on here? what part of this was the biggest project. The rest of the audience didn't seem to have any more of a clue than I did. What did she just say? The professor said something else in rapid English and asked him how on the screen to translate it. But she, if she was the right word, hesitated and went silent. I looked at the real Maho and she was responding exactly the same way. Dr. Leskine laughed cheerfully and responded to her. The conversation was in quick English and over half the audience couldn't understand it. The real Maho signed and took back the microphone.
このアマデウスに対して質問に答えてごらんと言いました。いつ頃までそのパパとお風呂に入っていたかとか、初恋はいつだったかとか、何でも答えられるだろうと。ああ、もうそれ以上通訳しなくていいわ。
The professor said something else and the Maho on the screen groaned and turned away. What was this? It was so natural, I couldn't tell at first, but this was something unbelievable, wasn't it? It felt very different than a typical AI, I could tell that much. It wasn't answering the questions I would give them, and because they were embarrassing? Was it programmed to respond like that to that certain questions for the purposes of this demonstration? It was possible that all it was, but if that conversation wasn't programmed in advance, the rest of the crowd seemed to reach the same conclusion I did, and the whispers started to turn to surprise. The copy of Maho was complaining to the original and felt like I was watching a pair of twin sisters talking. I'll walk back to the professor.
Minasan, mou o wakari ka to omoimasu ga, Amadeus wa jibun ga hanashite ii koto to sou de nai koto, arui wa hanashitai koto to hanashitaku nai koto o mizukara handan shite shabette imasu. Watashi tachi wa アマデウスにそういったプログラムを一切施していません。彼女は与えられた私の記憶からそれを独自に判断し、自律的にそういう行動をとっているのです。
The Maho on screen suddenly took over for her.
そしてこれは先ほどの医療分野への応用とは方向性が真逆になってしまい、研究所内でもずっと議論が交わされていることですが、私は不必要な情報をいつの間にか忘れてしまう。というか、記憶の引き出しから出してこられなくなるのです。皆さんと同じようにです。例えば、1週間前に着ていたパジャマの色。確かにそれを知っていたはずなのに、今は思い出せません。 そのような情報は生存していく上で必要がないからです。これも皆さんと同じです。このようにアマデウスは記憶のインプットやアウトプットが人間のそれと非常に近いのです。これは私たちも驚くべき結果として研究を重ねている最中で、まだ詳しくは解明されていません。
As Mao finished up, Dr. Leskinen took the microphone back. She resumed interpreting as he continued the lecture.
さらに、私たちを驚かせたのは、アマデウスが意図して嘘をつくということ。何らかのトラブルやミスではなく、わざとそうするのです。嘘は人間が他人とコミュニケーションを取る上での一つの手法です。アマデウスもインプットされた記憶を自律的に検討し、必要であれば自分や他人のために平気で嘘をつきます。教授、誤解を招くような言い方はやめてください。嘘をつくのに平気なことなんてありません。私だって両親は咎めます。
Dr. Leskinen cut off. He seemed to be hesitating. Mao didn't seem especially surprised by this. Maybe she knew the reason. But the moment passed and the professor continued. And Mao translated his words like there was nothing shocking about them at all.
このような検証を続けていくことで、最終的に私たちは、アマデウスに人間と同様の魂を宿すことができるのではないかと考えています。
I was stunned. So, should one of the leading brain scientists in the world really be using a word for such a vague definition?
これこそ本当の意味での人工知能ということになります。
The whole hall got very quiet, and it was sheer chaos for a while after that, as everyone tried to debate their own personal theories with Dr. Leskinen at once. So, thank you for listening.I will continue this in a few days. I hope you liked it. I'm sorry for my bad English. I am working on that. So thank you for watching, leave a like and subscribe, and we'll see each other next time.